Since early childhood, we are indoctrinated to believe that dinosaurs roamed on the surface of the earth millions of years ago. We were further told that this is a proven scientific fact. Let's see how much science there is really to it. If the dinosaurs indeed went extinct millions of years ago, then we shouldn't have been finding bones that are not yet fossilized but only frozen, or even soft tissue, red blood cells, protein, and so on. But we do find them. But most importantly, both ancient and medieval people were depicting often various types of dinosaurs with amazing accuracy. If what we call usually scientific history was correct, those folks shouldn't have had any clue at all how these creatures would look like. They knew how they look like because they saw them, and they painted them the way they saw them, interacting with people. As modern penguins find more and more old dinosaur bones and improve the skeletons, they find more and more details, and again they note, oh, and that was already there on that old medieval painting. Gate, gate, para gate, para sangate, bodhisattva. Gate, gate, para gate, para sangate, bodhisattva. Gate, gate, para gate, para sangate.
Para sangate bodhisattva.
The visual depictions of dinosaur-like creatures are not alone. We have also many historic records, stories telling us about encounters and interactions of humans with dinosaur-like creatures. Often they are called dragons or something else. And sure enough, it is supported by fossil evidence as well. For example, to start with the trails showing the tracks of dinosaurs and people along together with each other. Actually, the topic of coexistence of humans and dinosaurs together is very well covered already, and I'm only presenting a very brief overview. Information is readily available on YouTube for those who are interested. But I would just like to remind you that these tracks have been confirmed and always excavated by mainstream scientists themselves. Of course, they will never allow laymen to lead the digging. Michael Cremo has this excellent compilation of the works of hundreds of mainstream scholars proving the extreme antiquity of the human race, including all the way back to so-called dinosaur times. But how did it feel to share your life with dinosaurs? The most reliable and comprehensive source of such information that I am aware of would be the Acambaro collection. The museum has been recently closed down under suspicious circumstances, and the items are now in boxes locked with the government seal. Very strange. Why would they put government seals if they claim that these are just recent toys made by villagers? And how were these artifacts labeled as recent forgery? Well, very easily, by publishing an article in a reputed penguin magazine. According to his own words, the author of this article indeed did visit the area for 2-3 days. Just to give you an idea of what you can do in 2-3 days, the Laboratory for Alternative History, led by Andrei Zhukov, they had a team that stayed at the site indeed 3 days and managed to open a very small amount of the boxes, and it only took them just for photographing and trying to gather information about them. We are not talking about any serious study. So I believe they got a very quick glimpse of less than 20% of the items. That is a full team in 2 or 3 days. So that person who was found in the area, not studying them, he published this article full of straightforward, shameless lies that are visible, shining as lies as such, even to children who see the items, claiming that they're newly baked, intact, and so on and so on, which is not true. The artifacts clearly show signs of aging and also being underground for some time. Also, the Penguin article suggested the origin for these artifacts, and the origin was that the local villagers produced them within just a couple short months. But when Andrei Zhukov visited the actual location, he noticed that the villagers of that small settlement wouldn't have had the sheer manpower to do it. They're quite busy actually tilling their land. And the amount of artifacts is just thousands, by the way. Also, they don't have ovens or knowledge of making such a ceramic, neither experience in art or access to specialized literature that would give them all these details about the how dinosaurs did look like. And also this ceramic is it needs baking and under special conditions. It's not that easy to produce. That area happens not to have enough wood at all to even provide basic conditions for the making of these items. Another source of information about the details of a cohabitation of humans and dinosaurs could be the Ica stones, but the situation there is not as easy because many of them seem to be a forgery, and it is not sure which are the genuine ones so that we can learn from them. Well, wise mainstream scholars are always seen talking about carbon dating. It's such an important deity in their propaganda, but when it comes to the result that it gives on dinosaur bones, they are not eager to spread out the word for the results obtained in their own laboratories. Why? Because the bones show results of age few thousand years ago, not few million years ago. In addition, artifacts of human origin are found in those layers, supposedly dating from millions of years ago, the dinosaur layers, when we were, I don't know what kind of apes still, according to the penguins. There are still some tribes, even nowadays, that live in harmony with nature, and time to time they encounter the last remaining animals from the families of dinosaurs. Although such encounters are quite well documented and there are many eyewitnesses, still the mainstream science prefers to look just spaced out and looking in the other direction and not giving enough attention at all to the science of cryptozoology, for the simple reason that it may help people find out the truth that actually dinosaurs did not get extinct millions of years ago, but in very recent times, and in one sense are still getting extinct right now. A man was working with his tractor and he went out for a lunch. This is what he saw when he came back. Many huge residents of the beautiful earth and relatives of the dinosaurs are still alive on our planet. The governments create impression to the public that they're really working actively and do as much as possible to preserve Mother Nature. And while distracting our attention with poetic phrases of Mother Nature, they are in a great haste to rape their mother as soon as possible from all sides. In reality, preserving the last few normal places, normal habitats in our planet together with the tribes that live there is not at all costly affair compared, for example, with the military expenses. It is a very small fraction of it. The money needed to save all the pristine places of our planet is a very small fraction of what is regularly created and given for free to banksters, for example. How they create it? It's very simple. You take your computer keyboard, type 1 or any other number, and then many zeros after it, and then press enter. After that, of course, if you work at the right place, you can distribute the created millions and billions to bankrupting banks so that they can continue widening the gap between rich and poor. So what are the conclusions? Dinosaurs did not get extinct millions of years ago, but thousands of years ago, and we are at the final phases of the extinction of that family or families of animals. For how long were they around? We don't have the slightest clue, actually, because we don't have the slightest clue about the history of our planet in those times anyway. Now, this frozen dinosaur bone was found actually in the pile of mass mammoth graves in Siberia, entangled with everything else. That doesn't mean that all the dinosaurs got extinct at that time, but at least we know that the event that swept away the mammoths also swept away some of the dinosaurs. In general, the history as we know it for the last 200 years or so is more or less correct. Let's say it's 70% real history and 30% propaganda. And then the history of the last 1,000 years would be more or less correct, let's say 40% truth, and it would actually include the events of what is usually presented to us to have happened the last 2,000-3,000 years. They would be usually in reality compressed within the 1,000 years and severely distorted. Distorted like this, they are talking about something real, but it is presented in such a light that at the end it becomes something that doesn't exist. And then beyond that boundary, which I only guess it's 1,000 years ago, it seems to be a pure and total fantasy and propaganda instead of history. I have already received a few replies in response to my call for remote viewers, and I will be definitely organizing remote viewing projects. And hopefully the results of those combined with the study of the Vedas could hopefully result in making some sort of sensible timeline of what was happening on our planet thousands of years ago and maybe even millions of years ago. And when I say Vedas, now I mean it in a broader sense. Even I myself before used to use it in the sense that most of us know, that is the Indian Vedic literature. However, there is another Vedic literature as well from the Slavic nations, and also part of it is preserved in the Scandinavian legends and old books. And I don't know how about the Scandinavian ones, but the Slavic ones clearly call themselves, name themselves as Vedas. Exactly, this word Veda is an archaic word for knowing, the verb know. Maybe many of you of Slavic origin will be familiar with the phrase as Buki Vedi in relation to the first Slavic alphabet. And just a small clarification, when I said that I call all remote viewers, I'm using this word remote viewing because this is the scientific term for what in the past used to be called shamanic visions, or the New Age people call it accessing Akashic records. Some people use the lucid dream technique. There are many techniques, and ultimately, it all boils down to the very same thing, accessing that information that is stored in the primeval fabric of our creation. Our history has not been lost and can never be lost. It can be recovered in minute detail and will be because it is kept, it is recorded forever. Once we shift the priority of our life from watching basketball and drinking Coke to knowing who are we, then everything will be revealed. And a bit of additional information on the Starfords topic opened recently. I simply forgot to include very important information. Look at this Starford. This is the famous Sacsayhuaman in Peru. Most of you are probably already aware with the most recent research showing that its gigantic walls are made of geopolymer and not a natural stone as such. But what really deserves attention is the attitude that the mass media is creating about towards this historic site. It is always immediately listed as some sort of military fortification, automatically, just like that, without the need of any confirmation. But when one has an actual look on the map and visiting the site in reality, one will quickly see that this has no strategic position at all, and it makes no sense building it at such a location. It simply doesn't defend anything. It defends the small amount of buildings on one side only. So this is suspicious, making us think that it is a fortification, military by default, without any proof of it. Well, what's the problem with saying I don't know? Also, we are constantly assured by wisely sounding phrases that it was built by some sort of pre-Inca culture. The Quilque culture. So they're showing us a few pieces of old pottery, and that's the proof of all their story. I mean, how do they know what were these Quilque people? How did they know the recipe of geopolymers? For what purpose did they build this impressive structure? It's all quite inconsistent. It looks like they're just making it up so that to create the impression that we have it all figured out. The most sensible research on the Sacsayhuaman that I have seen till now is the one done by Andres Klarov and his team, Laboratory of Alternative History. They think that it looks like some sort of a landing place, or maybe some tests were performed, and actually this zigzag structure is maybe meant to somehow break the waves of energy coming from this platform, whatever was happening on it. And then, sure enough, the eternal companions of the structures of the survivors. The round crater holes. Now, a very well equipped Russian group of scientists, it's a long story how did they get this opportunity from the Peruvian government, but they did extensive testing in this officially, I think it's called a lake or something like that. And their definite conclusion was that this seems to be an aftermath of something like bombing. And then this morning I received this old image of a Starford. So what we see here, yes, there seems to be some guns pointing out, but the question arises, what exactly were they defending? Most of it seems to consist of just a beautiful artwork, lace, stonework of angles and geometric forms. It does look somewhat like a technical equipment of some sort inside. And this is something else that somebody sent me. Somebody took this aerial photo somewhere in the area of a whitewater ski resort in Canada. It only says that it is in a lake, but which lake? There is this duck lake in the area that I found on Google Earth, blurred completely. Interesting. If somebody knows anything, please write to me.